I have two books at my bedside, Lieutenant. The Marine Corps Code of Conduct and the King James Bible.
I hate snakes, Doc! I hate them!
And may the Christian Lord guide my hand against your Roman popery!
And they may take our lives, but they'll never take our freedom!
We're on a mission from God.
Entitled. You want answers!
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth!
Maybe we should chug on over to Mamby Pamby Land, where maybe we can find some self-confidence for you, you jackwagon!
Coming to you live from his padded cell high atop Bethel Church, the most heralded, the most despised talk show in all of human history. This is the talk show Hell Hates. This is Pastor Mike Online.
Now here we are coming to you live. No, not live. Not live. Not even close to being live. It's way past being live. Probably by the time you get this, it'll be way past your bedtime. So, and here's what I don't get. So, several of you sent me messages, emails, you know, things like that, offering to help with computers and so on. And I'm going to be honest with you. I don't think that it was a computer problem. Now, let me explain that. Yes, obviously the computer faulted. But that computer, I'll give you the history of it. I had it custom built for what I do in that padded cell high atop Bethel Church. I do Pastor Mike Online, and I did for several years. I also set that computer up with a digital audio workshop, a DAW, they call it, which basically is like a recording studio on your computer. I have used... It used to be called Cakewalk. Then it was called Sonar. The company was still called Cakewalk. But then they went out of business, or somebody bought them out or something like that. And it's run by a company called BandLab, which I'd never heard before. But it's actually free now. And I paid, you know, a few hundred bucks for it. But anyway... other than that, you know, somebody asked me, could it be a virus? When it comes to my streaming computers, I'm very careful. I take very good care of them, especially the one that we use to stream the church services in. The only thing that that computer does is stream our live services. And display a PDF of our hymn book and display a PowerPoint if we need it to. And that's it. There's no other software on that computer. And it's similar to the one I was using today. I'm very careful about what software I put on there. I don't download what screensavers. That's a virus in a box is what they are. I don't go to websites hardly unless somebody sends me a link to like a news thing or whatever. That computer worked flawlessly. And so when we started having problems with our church streaming computer, I thought, well, I'll put this one and we'll use it to stream the church service. Simply because there's nothing that ever goes wrong with it, and it should work. And it did, but we upgraded our video system. So that required a little bit more computing capability than what that computer was able to do. So we just kind of set it to the wayside. When I came back from vacation, my home computer, which is similar to the one I use for PMO, I'm pretty picky about what software I install on it, what I do. 90% of what I do on a computer is either music production, video production, working on, you know, Watchmen scripts, sermon outlines, and I watch some YouTube videos, and that's pretty much it. So again, I don't think it was a virus. But here we are again. And how many times, if you've been watching me over the years, how many times has 1 o'clock rolled around, 12 o'clock rolled around when I'm supposed to be doing Pastor Mike Online? Everything works fine, then the internet shuts off. Everything works fine, and then the computer won't come on. Everything works fine, and then there's sound problems. I mean, it's happened over and over and over again, and it happened basically a total of, I think, 4 times today. I gave it a shot. I tried and I tried and I tried and I tried, and it kept shutting off. And part of it, you were able to see, I was explaining that it was going to shut off, and it shut off right then. So anyway, I am going to displace that computer. Probably won't retire it. I'll probably find something else for it to do. But I won't use it for streaming. I just ordered a brand new computer. For those of you who know computers, I think it's a 12-core system, which means 12 processors working at about 3.5 gigahertz. So 12 times 3 is 36, plus another half of that would be probably close to 40 or 50 gigahertz, which is pretty good speed, pretty good processing speed. 32 gigabytes of RAM, which is very important when you're streaming. The graphics card has to be able to handle. This really isn't high-end graphics. It's a webcam. I mean, really, it's not much. But anyway, it should do. It's a 2 terabyte solid-state drive, which means the new hard drives are coming out with. They have no moving parts. They're like SD cards that you put in your cameras or whatever. That's basically what a solid state drive is. No moving parts. It's all chips, and it retrieves data very, very quickly. So anyway, it'll be on the way next week. I won't have it up and running before homecoming, I can tell you that, or probably won't have it. So I might do Pastor Mike Online from a different computer. I'll have to figure out which one will work the best. Anyway, good to be with you today. Here's what I had planned for today. I was going to answer your questions. I do that from time to time, and some of you have written some pretty interesting questions. I was planning on doing this live, and I was going to monitor my Pastor Mike Online at gmail.com email address, and if you had anything while I was talking, you could send it in. But since it's not live, don't do it. I mean, I probably won't see it. I'll be getting ready for homecoming next week, so I can almost guarantee you I won't see hardly any of those emails. I might check it every now and then to see, you know, if there's a very important need in someone's life. Someone reached out to me last week who is dealing with an addiction. And that's something that I want to help this person with. So I gave them our church, you know, phone number. I said, call, you know, during the week, next week, and you know, we'll talk about whatever. He didn't explain much, but he just had some questions about it. So I like to help people like that. You have heard me mention, just kind of giving you some updates off the top of my mind. A person in our church who could, and I'm being careful with my words, I don't want to give out publicly too much information, but someone in our church really in danger. In there could be their life in danger. And this morning, this person, along with a relative and a lawyer, tried to get a temporary emergency ex parte, which is a restraining order. And we were very hopeful, because of the situation that's ongoing, we were pretty hopeful that that was a shoe-in, the judge would approve it, but she didn't. And I was really, my heart just aches for this person. And you just pray, please, with me. I'm not going to give you a name. I'm not going to say him, her, anything like that. Just pray for this person. God knows who it is. God knows the need. And I'm asking you to pray. So just lift this person up in your prayers, if you would, please. Now, let's start out with, it was sort of a criticism. I don't think I was mean in anything I said, but I was pretty stern with how I responded, because I was accused of, I wouldn't say I was accused. Let me tell you the story. We're going to go in our Bibles to the book of Acts, chapter 1. And I've actually heard this from a former pastor of Bethel Church during my, I'd say, teenage years. Okay, I remember a pastor that I really loved. I loved all the pastors at Bethel. But anyway, and he's now gone on to be with the Lord. If he were here today, he and I would have a disagreement on this issue. And it's the issue of, in Acts chapter 1, the issue of a man by the name of Matthias. Does that ring a bell with anybody? Anybody ring bells? Okay. Let me put La Scripture on La Screen. And voila, there it is. You know what? I want to make this bigger. So let's see here. Text, color, and fonts. Let's see. Scripture browser. Let's make that like a 22-point text. That's a little bit easier for you to see, maybe. All right. So we go to Acts chapter 1, and the email that was sent to me, the person had heard me in a Pastor Mike online broadcast. I don't know when I said this, and I think I've only talked about it maybe once or twice in all the ministry years. But anyway, the disciples, after the demise of Judas Iscariot, were left with an empty chair. And it was, I believe, by direction of the Holy Spirit that it fell upon them to fill that vacant chair. And I'll explain why I believe that. Well, the person who wrote the email, God bless them. I don't know that they've written back a response. I checked a couple times. I haven't checked every day. But anyway, this person said that I was basically favoring what amounted to a false apostle. That Matthias was not and could not have been a real apostle. And so, you know what? Maybe I can do this. Let me try to do something here real quick. Let me see if I can find the actual email. And, no, let's see here. No, I don't see it. So anyway, we'll just leave it at that. I'm just going to try to paraphrase as best I can what the guy said. He basically said that Matthias was a false apostle and that position should have been filled by the apostle Paul. And so basically, therefore, I was favoring the choosing of a false apostle. One of the things, if I remember them right, that's why I wanted to check the email, was one of the things that they said in the email was that the apostles in Acts chapter 1 that chose Matthias had not received the outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Therefore, they were not following the Spirit or the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost or whatever. They were not following the Holy Spirit when they chose Matthias to be the 12th apostle to replace Judas Iscariot. And when I read that, and he said, you know, therefore, they got ahead of what Christ said. I think the email said that Jesus did not tell them to pick one. The Holy Ghost did not tell them to pick one. So therefore, they were in error. Now, we're talking about the apostles. And understand something. If there was a man or a group of men who were specifically delegated the charge of the formation and the foundation of the New Testament, New Covenant Church, it would be those apostles. They are, the Bible says, they are the foundation of the church, Jesus Christ himself being the, let's look that one up so you know I'm not making it up here. Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, cornerstoner. That, well, maybe it's corner space stone. There we go. That sounds right. Ephesians 2:20. The Bible says, now you therefore are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets. And you know what that is? The apostles, New Testament. The prophets, Old Testament. We're built upon the foundation of both parts of the Bible, the apostles and the prophets. The foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Now, the man did reference in his email the 12 apostles being the foundation of heavenly Jerusalem, and he was correct on that. Let's see if I can find it here. City lieth four square. Let's see here. La da da. This is just fun going through scriptures. It's probably in chapter 22. I probably missed it already. Yeah, I did. I missed it. I goofed. I saw new heaven and earth and holy city Jerusalem, the tabernacle of God. The former things are passed away. Let's see here. Having the glory of God, her light was like unto a stone, most precious, even like a jasper stone, clear as crystal, and had a wall great and high, and had 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and names written thereon, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. And it goes into the gates. And then verse 14, and the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and in them the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. So yes, when Jesus selected those 12 men, including Judas Iscariot, he knew, number one, that Judas was going to fall away. Satan was going to possess him. He was going to sell him out for 30 pieces of silver. That was all recorded in Scripture. That he would hang himself from a tree. Cursed be anyone that hangeth from a tree. So Judas Iscariot is cursed. And I've had some people who believe in, you know, once prayed, always saved. At least one of them say that they believe that Judas had to be in heaven, because you can't lose your salvation. And I'm going, oh, good grief. The Bible made it clear that he's cursed, hanging from a tree. All right. So now his office is vacant, and the number has to be 12. Why? Well, there's numerical reasons. I'm not going to get into that. I'm actually working on the number 12 as part of an upcoming Watchman broadcast. But it matches the 12 tribes of Israel from the Old Covenant. So we have the elders of the 12 tribes, which is, you know, Reuben, Simeon, Levi, Judah, and all the rest of them, the other eight brothers. Those 12 patriarchs who were the sons of Jacob. They are the heads of the tribes, Jewish men, and each one of them has a gate. Then we have 12 apostles. Again, Jewish men. And, you know, we like to think, well, you know, that's the New Testament and that's all, it's for the Gentiles. And yeah, but the New Testament starts with Matthew chapter 1, and it says, this is the book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of David, okay, the son of God. He was a Jew, and the 12 men that he picked were Jews as well. So this is the Jewish religion, the true Jewish religion. Most of the Jews just haven't figured it out yet. But anyway, so he said that Matthias could not be that 12th apostle. He was a false apostle. Again, and what this man, I don't know if he realizes what he's doing. He's laying a charge, not against me, but against the 11 apostles, of whom the church is built upon them. One of the duties of an apostle is you write doctrine. Okay? That's why there are no more apostles after John died in AD 95, somewhere around in there. After John died, there are no more apostles. There's no apostolic succession. There is no one who qualifies for that. And I'll read the qualifications of an apostle. So he's laying actually a charge, not against me, but against the apostles, for choosing as one of their co-laborers a false apostle. In other words, we just replaced a man who was possessed by Satan himself with a liar and a deceiver, because that's what the Bible says false apostles are. And I'll read that in a minute. So let's go to, let's go down to the Dairy Queen, the Scrumptilicious Dairy, Acts chapter 1. All right, Acts chapter 1. So Jesus has now departed, and the man was right in that as he's giving them instructions, he's telling them to go and preach, you know, in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the othermost parts of the earth, and so on and so forth. He doesn't say to them, the two angels are coming down. Hold up a second. I forgot to tell you, pick another apostle. Okay, angels, we can go now. He didn't say that there. He didn't say that in Acts chapter 1. But he did tell them to do it. So let's read. So let's go to verse 12. Then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is from Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey. And when they were come in, they went up into an upper room where abode both Peter, James, John, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, Simon Zelotes, and Judas the brother of James. So we have 11. Judas Iscariot. By now, his body has rotted off of the rope and his blood everywhere. So it says in verse 14, these all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. And in those days, Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples. And I kind of like this. You don't ever actually have Jesus giving one of these to Peter and saying, you're the Pope. You don't have anything like that at all. What you do have in every, in every listing of the names of the apostles, Peter's name is always first. Doesn't matter who's all in the middle. Judas is always last, but Peter's always first. And you can see in John, you can see a very unique and special relationship between Christ and John. John referring to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. But you can see also in Peter's character. And I like every now and then to just, examine the character of some of these people in the Bible, just from reading what you're reading. You know, people like Samson. You know, what was Samson's, what made him tick? What made him do something? What was his weaknesses? And you can see in Samson's life that his character was he could not turn down a lady. Couldn't do it. He loved women, lots of them. Solomon was the same way. When you look at Peter's character, there's in any group, doesn't matter if it's children playing in the school playground, or in the classroom, or in a college setting, or in a business setting, or in a church, or what have you. There are always people who, it's not like their whole goal in life is to take over and dominate everything that they're part of. It's just that they seem to be leaders by nature. Okay, that's who they are. And that's who Peter seems to be, even though, like we say, we have no scripture where Jesus said, you're the head apostle, you're the bishop of Rome, Everything you say counts as if God was saying it from here, and all your success. Nothing like that was ever said. But we have Peter standing up. And the same thing. Who is it out of all the preachers on the day of Pentecost preaching in these other languages whose sermon is recorded for us in Scripture? It's Peter. So Peter does take a prominent role among the disciples, but he's by no means infallible. And Paul had to confront him to the face in front of a bunch of people about how he was doing things that are wrong. So anyway, but Peter stood up. they're all praying. They're giving themselves over to it. They're probably attending to the scriptures. And he said, and in those days, Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples and said, the number of names together were about 120 men and brethren. This scripture must needs have been fulfilled, which the Holy Ghost by the mouth of David spake before concerning Judas, which was guide to them that took Jesus. What is Peter doing here? He's referring to the Holy Ghost in the form of what? The scriptures. Because he said, and he's quoting it now, verse 17, for he was numbered among us, or numbered with us, and had obtained part of this ministry. Now this man purchased a field with the reward of iniquity. Falling headlong, he burst asunder in the midst, and all his bowels gushed out. That'd make a nice movie. And it was known unto all the dwellers at Jerusalem, insomuch that the field is called in their proper tongue, Akeldama, that is to say, the field of blood. For it is written in the book of Psalms, let his habitation be desolate, and let no man dwell therein, and his bishopric let another take. Wherefore these men which have company with them, and I'll get to that in a minute. So let's go back to the book of Psalms where that is. I don't think it actually uses the term bishopric. I think it uses the term office. And we'll see if I'm right. Let's see here. Ding, 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 ding. What, Psalm 109. Set thou a wicked man over him, and let Satan stand at his right hand. When he shall be judged, let him be condemned, and let his prayer become sin. Let his days be few, and let another take his office. Let his children be fatherless, and his wife a widow, so on and so on. So, I mean, Psalm 109, verse 8, is not a verse that you just go around memorizing all day, like John 3:16 and Romans 3:23 and Psalm 23. And it just kind of sticks out there, and it doesn't really give clarity as to what it means until the disciples are there, the apostles are there, the 11 are gathered together, they're in prayer, and they're reading the scriptures, and Peter is... And when the guy who wrote me the email said that they were not being led by the Holy Spirit because the Holy Spirit had been poured out yet, I wrote back to him and I said, I disagree with you. They were being commanded by the Holy Spirit, by Jesus himself. In what form? The Holy Scriptures. And I said, unless, of course, you don't regard the Scriptures as being the same and one with the Holy Ghost. And that's kind of how I left the email. So we go back to the book of Acts. Peter is not in error. He's probably reading Psalms. And he stands up. And he says, he was numbered with us, but it's written in the Psalms, let his habitation be desolate, let no man dwell therein, and his bishopric let another take. So the Holy Ghost is commanding Peter and the remaining apostles to choose a new apostle. And here are the qualifications. Verse 21. Wherefore these men which have accompanied with us all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us. Qualification number one. He had to have been somebody who had been with the original 12 disciples, but wasn't given the office of the apostles at that time. But he certainly had been with Jesus. It wasn't just 12 men with Jesus. There was several men and women that accompanied Jesus from time to time. So he had to have been with the disciples and with Jesus throughout his ministry. That's first qualification. Beginning from the baptism of John unto that same day that he was taken up from us, must one be ordained to be a witness with us of his resurrection. That's another qualification. And so when it comes to these people who call themselves apostles today, are they actually apostles? I don't agree with that. Now, I'm going to say this for my Kenyan brethren. I know that it is a common practice among many of the churches in Kenya that the various pastors will have someone who is like a teacher to them, a guide, a mentor, someone that they believe has authority over them, and someone who is there to lead and guide them in, number one, forming a church, number two, in building and growing that church, number three, for maintaining proper doctrine, etc., etc., etc. And they will call this man an apostle. I don't necessarily take offense at that. I don't get twisted out of shape over it. I don't get angry over it. I have men, obviously, that I've actually gone to and said to them, will you watch over me? Will you, if you see me going wrong or going astray in some way, will you come to me and correct me? Will you do that? And I've said that specifically to two men. There's a couple more that I am probably going to ask in the near future. Men that I am telling them, watch over me. Be a gatekeeper of my mouth. If I start saying things that you know are not biblical, give me a call. I will not be offended. I know every now and then I need to be corrected. And so I don't get out of shape over that. When I hear it amongst various of the churches in Africa, I know it's a thing there. Maybe a different word would apply here, but that's just sort of how they see it. That's my understanding of it, all right? But when it comes to the official apostles, the original 12, including Matthias here, who they're about to pick. He is the one qualified under these terms, that he had been with Jesus, he was a witness of his resurrection, and so on. And so, in verse 23, and they appointed two, Joseph called Barsabbas, who was surnamed Justus, and Matthias. And they prayed. And they said, Thou, Lord, which knowest the hearts of all men, show whether of these two thou hast chosen. Now, in the email that I received, what the arguments that the man used, none of them included scripture. The only reference was to the place in Revelation where the 12 foundations are named after the 12 apostles. Okay? But he accuses, again, he's accusing the apostles of choosing a false apostle. But and I didn't mention this in the email. They didn't choose him. They didn't choose him. The Holy Ghost chose him. That's clear from their prayer and their method. Look at it. They prayed, Thou, Lord, knowest, which knowest the hearts of all men, show whether these two thou hast chosen. Not what we chose, what you chose. Who you choose. You're the one who's going to pick one of these men, that he may take part of this ministry and apostleship from which Judas by transgression fell, that he might go to his own place. And they gave forth their lots. Now, we don't know exactly what casting lots were, but they cast lots. That was a common thing. And how did they pick? How did Joshua pick Achan? Out of all the people of Israel that were in on the raid and the attack of Jericho, and God told them specifically, do not take any of their clothes, their gold, nothing. Take nothing from them. Burn it all. How did Joshua choose Achan? They cast lots, first of all, to find the tribe. They cast lots again to find the family head. They cast lots again, and I believe that time they found that it was Achan. And when they called Achan forth, Joshua didn't ask him, did you do this? If I remember right, Joshua said, why hast thou done this? Something like that. It was the Holy Ghost, by way of casting what would seem to be some sort of random thing, like rolling dice, and, you know, let's picture that's what they did. They had a pair of dice in their hand, and they said, if it comes up snake eyes, which is all ones, then it's going to be Barsabbas. But if it comes up all fives or whatever, then it's going to be Matthias. And they rolled the dice, or they cast the lots, and the Holy Ghost, say, I don't believe in luck. The Holy Ghost laid out that lot, and it was clear to them that the Holy Ghost had chosen Matthias. Clearly. Now, here's what you don't have from this point forward. And they gave forth their lots, and the lot fell upon Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. Now, the scripture has been fulfilled that David said 1,000 years before this day. Okay? 3,000 years ago. Now the scripture is fulfilled. So, here's what you don't have after this scripture. You don't have any mention of Matthias whatsoever. Nothing that I can recall. Obviously, he was a disciple. And in saying that you don't have any mention of it, you don't have God intervening and saying to Peter or any of the other apostles, what is this thou hast done? Why hast thou done thus, Lee? Something like that. Some sort of King James language thing. Why did you do this? Matthias is not the apostle of God. You chose the wrong one. But remember, they didn't choose him. They cast lots, and the lot the Holy Ghost used to choose Matthias. So no, number one, no accusation from God or Jesus at any time correcting the alleged error that they made in Acts chapter 1. Now, the man did mention that Paul should have been the 12th apostle, not Matthias. Well, God just happens to do things in patterns, doesn't he? So let's calculate this out here. How many tribes do we have? 12. How many apostles? 12. And Paul? 13, which we originally, then the total number would have been 14, but Judas Iscariot is no longer named in that pile of apostles. So now we have, starting with Peter, we have the list going all the way down now to Matthias. He's the 12th. And then God later calls Saul of Tarsus, gives him the office of apostle to the Gentiles. All right? What's the Old Testament equivalent to that? Remember, Jacob had 12 sons, correct? But one of those sons, there was a division of one of the sons of Jacob. There was a division made in Jacob's grandsons, two of them. Do you know who I'm talking about? Manasseh and Ephraim. So you have the 12 tribes, but Joseph's tribe is actually two tribes, different tribes. The half tribe, and the Bible always says the half tribe of Manasseh, half tribe of Manasseh, all through the Old Testament, half tribe of Manasseh. Then we have Ephraim. And we have all 12 of those surrounding the sanctuary and the most holy place and so on, the Ark of the Covenant in the wilderness. And then we have the Levites, who are not given a specific inheritance of land. Their inheritance is the Lord. Their inheritance is that they work for the Lord. So now, how many tribes, how many groups do we have that get an inheritance? 13. The Levites, of course, their inheritance is of the Lord. And the other 12, one of them is Joseph's tribe divided in two, Manasseh and Ephraim. And here's what's interesting. When we get to the last mention of the names of the tribes of Israel, The official listing is Revelation 7, Judah, Reuben, Gad, Asher, Nephilim, Manasseh, Simeon, Levi, Issachar, Zebulun, Joseph, and Benjamin. It's 12,000. Okay, that's 12. Because both tribes of Joseph are mentioned. One of them is Manasseh, not Molasses, Manasseh, and the other one, Ephraim, is the tribe of Joseph mentioned in verse 8. But there was one taken out, wasn't there? Just like in the list of the apostles, there was one taken out. Who was it? Dan. Dan is missing just like in the last, in the very last listing of the 12 apostles of Jesus Christ, just like Dan is missing from the last official list of the 12 tribes of Israel in Revelation 7, Judas is missing out of the very last list of the apostles of Jesus Christ in Acts chapter 1. It's the same pattern. You have 12. No, you have 13. And then you got, you know, then you've got, you know, Joseph splitting in half, and then Dan leaves, and now you're back to 12 again. And then there's Paul, the number 13, who is part of them, if you follow what I'm saying. It follows the same pattern. There was one extra. God took one out, tossed him out. He took Dan out, Revelation 7. He took Judas out in Acts chapter 1. Okay? That's the best explanation that I have. Do I believe it or not, I actually had a lady write me an email a few years ago saying that she was now convinced that Paul was a false apostle. In fact, let's look that up. False apostles. And I'm going, where in the world? And I knew almost immediately where she had got it from. Second Corinthians 11:13. 2 Corinthians 11 is where we're warned about another Jesus, another spirit, and another gospel. Now we're worried. Now we're warned about false apostles. For such are false apostles. And what do false apostles do? They are deceitful workers. So what this man basically was saying was that the Holy Ghost picked a deceitful worker, Matthias, to be among the 12 of the apostles. And I'm going, not buying it. Transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ, and no marvel, for Satan himself. I mean, and think about this. Is there a 21st century equivalent of the term false apostles right now? Yes, it's in the Catholic Church. Because the Catholic Church believes in apostolic succession. They have transformed themselves into the apostles of Christ when they're not. Pope Francis was not with the original 12 disciples who, from Jesus' baptism onward, traveled with Jesus. He was not a witness to his resurrection. Therefore, he is not qualified to be an apostle. He's not qualified to write doctrine and tell me what to believe. So he is a false apostle. He has transformed himself into that. or that church did that for him. Either way, he is a false apostle, a deceitful worker. And what is he deceiving them with? A false gospel. Pray to this image of Mary. Give us your money. You can be forgiven of part of your sins. No salvation whatsoever. All right. Let's see here. Let me look through my... there was some emails. I was going to mention the lady that said that Paul was a false apostle. And as soon as she said it, I'm going, I think I know where you're getting this from. And what she had been doing, she had been reading some Hebrew Roots websites. I haven't talked about in a while. I probably need to bring that up again and visit it a while, because they're still out there. Jim Staley's out of prison. I don't know what he's doing. I haven't heard much of anything from him, but he's out of prison now, and I'm sure he's trying somehow, some way to deceive people to get the money rolling back in like he had before. And he had it rolling in. He had big bucks rolling in, I'm telling you. But anyway, she said God has shown her that Paul was a false apostle. And what it is, the Hebrew Roots people don't like Paul. They don't like his writings. They don't like the book of Galatians. They don't like the book of Romans, because it disqualifies all of their doctrine. And they have to spend huge amount of resources trying to unsay what Paul said. So instead of doing that, they just say that Paul was a false apostle and his book should have never been put in the Bible. That was done by the pagan Grecian Roman sun god worshipers who go to church on the Sunday. You all pagan worshipers, because you go to church on Sunday. Well, what about the people who go to church on Saturn's day? But anyway, so that was her thing. And I showed her from scripture. I said, wait a minute. You mean to tell me that you believe that Paul was a false apostle, and yet here we have Peter, who, what was it, 2 Peter? Peter tells all of his disciples to go read Paul's letters. Peter didn't think he was a false apostle. And apparently God didn't think that Matthias was one either. Let's see here. What else came in? Let me see if I can find it. All right, here's a question. And I'm going to admit now that I don't know everything there is to know about this particular subject. A person writes me, and they are, let's see, where are they from? They are from Norway. And in Europe, Muslim immigrants have flooded Europe. They're everywhere. Which is funny because, well, it's funny in a bizarre, strange, very bad way, that nations like Norway, Sweden, Denmark, the Netherlands, Holland, all of those Scandinavian nations at one time were Calvin Protestants. Okay? That most of their nation's flags have a cross in it. And there are still these old churches all throughout the Scandinavian nations. Christianity had really made its mark in these northern European nations. But now, because most of those people have turned their back on God, God has sent in among them all of these Muslims. And of course, you know, wherever a Muslim community is, they insist on everything going exactly their way. And there are things you can't do simply because they're standing within 50 yards of you. Okay? Like wearing a t-shirt with a pig on it. So anyway, that happened in England. Remember Peppa Pig? And the little girl had this Peppa Pig hat or something like that on it, got on a bus with her mom, and the bus driver threw her off because some Muslim woman complained that that was unclean and it was defiling and offensive to her. So they threw the mom and the little kid off of the bus because she was wearing a Peppa Pig t-shirt. That's stupid. Anyway, so this brother in Norway is asking the question. He said, is eating halal food a sin for Christians? Halal food is Islamic, and Islamic religion is an anti-Christian religion. The food items that people can buy in a grocery store are marked with halal mark. What does halal mark mean? All right, so my answer to him was essentially this. Here's my understanding of it, and you may disagree, and that's fine. I will honor your disagreement. If I look further into it, I might end up agreeing with you. But remember one thing before I say anything else on this. Let's go back. Let's go back to the replay here, Dan. Come on. Get our replay here. Let's see here. I love Thanksgiving. All right. 1 Timothy 4. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from what? The works? Nope. The faith. Giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. Brothers and sisters, I am reading a lot of alien abduction stories. This book here, Alien Abduction Files, was written by Kathleen Marden. Kathleen Marden was Betty Hill's niece. Betty and Barney Hill were the first scientifically studied abductees in history. Now, there were abductees before Betty and Barney Hill, but theirs was the first to really make headlines and be studied, and they were doing hypnotic regressions and all this stuff. And I can tell you that in reading these stories, 100%, I can tell you that what the world calls aliens, yes, they are alien to this world. They're not from here. But what the world calls aliens, the Bible calls them devils, evil spirits, unclean spirits, familiar spirits. And these devils have doctrines that they're teaching mankind. And they are, let's see here, they are seducing spirits. Whitley Strieber, the man who wrote Communion. I want you to think about that word, communion. We have a communion service whereby we participate and practice what Jesus told us to do. We break the bread, we drink the fruit of the vine, and that, you know, is a symbol of joining us, or our joining with Christ in his sufferings and then later his glory. So by doing that, we are symbolizing the unity that exists between Christ and us, the church. So it was actually Whitley Strieber's wife who gave him the idea for the title of that book, Communion. Because that's exactly what it was. That alien figure that was on the cover of Communion, he had an artist draw up this face. They spent a lot of time getting the details right. And Strieber then comes out and says, oh, by the way, this alien here on the picture was a female. And he committed fornication with her on multiple occasions. That's seducing spirits. And I have other stories to tell you later on. Verse 2, they speak lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron. Forbidding to marry, commanding to abstain from meats. Like Catholicism telling you you can't eat meat on Friday. So we have fish. That's not meat. It is. But that's no different than the dietary laws of eating kosher and the dietary laws of halal. And in my humble opinion, halal is basically the Muslim version of Jewish kosher. And I'll explain it in a minute. But remember this. Forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from meats, which God hath created to be received with thanksgiving of them which believe and know the truth. So I'm just going to ask you, those of you who are about to come unglued in a nice Christian fashion, the way you've seen me do on occasions, are we saved by eating something? No. Do we lose our salvation by eating something? No. Does God place curses on us because we ate certain things? No. Does God not bless us because we ate certain things? No. None of those statements are true. None of them are. Look what the apostle, remember they have authority, right? They write doctrine. For every creature of God is good, like catfish. I like catfish. I do. And some only like farm-raised catfish. Me and my dad, we used to go out the Mississippi River and fish for catfish, get them right out of that river, that muddy Mississippi River, and eat them. And I say the muddier the better. But you know, catfish is in the list of the Old Testament as being an unclean animal. It doesn't have scales. It's a bottom feeder. It is. It rolls around on the bottom of wherever lake or river they're in and just waiting for some kind of scummy thing to fall in their mouth so they eat it. Okay? God, for every creature of God is good and nothing to be refused if it be received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God and prayer. Now let me give you the opposite of that. When a Jewish rabbi places his stamp of kosher approval on whatever delicatessen meat or whatever, Their belief is that he, the rabbi, has declared it to be sanctified, righteous, and holy to be eaten by Jews. Okay? It's the same with halal. From my understanding, you know, a lot of Muslims, they like lamb, goat. I've had goat in Kenya and in a stew. I like it. I had goat stew in Kenya. It's very good. They make a wonderful stew. Kebabs and what is it? Doners. If you've ever gone into a doner shop where they've got this big thing of meat on a spit and it turns slowly and this fire basically cooks it as it rolls by that fire, and when it comes around the guy takes his knife and shaves it off literally into a bun for you and puts some dressing on it and whatever you want and gives it to you. Buddy, that'll make a puppy pull a freight train. It is good. That's good eating. Okay? But that lamb has to be halal before any Muslim can eat it. And it's the same thing. And part of, let me just give you an example. I'm just guessing on this, but I would say that if a butcher used a knife or a cleaver and he cut up this hog, this pig, and then he, you know, may have just wiped it off, and then he cut up this lamb for some Muslims that were going to buy lamb, well, that would not be halal because the knife has been defiled by touching this swine flesh, and then the same knife defiled by the swine flesh is cutting up this lamb, and that food, according to Muslims, is unclean. It's dirty. It's evil. You can't eat it. Allah will kill you, or whatever. That's my understanding of it. Now, again, may not be the best sanitary ways to do it, but does God take away your salvation because you went to I think it's D-O-N-A-R, donor, a donor shop, and got donor, you know, donor sandwich or whatever, lamb and beef sandwich, and it was halal? No. Now, some have said that they believe that it is food sacrificed to idols. Okay? Now, we have in Acts 15 what the apostles and the elders told us on the question of, do the Gentiles, are they saved by the law, or are they saved by grace, or whatever? They all agreed, we're all saved by grace, Jew or Gentile. But they did say that, we write unto them, they abstained from pollutions of idols, from fornication, from things strangled, and from blood. Now, I personally am not aware of any idol that Muslims have other than the Kaaba at Mecca. And I don't know if their food has any connection with that. I don't know. But what also did Paul say about not offending his brother, someone who may be weak in the faith or a new Christian? and maybe he just got saved from being a Muslim, and he's rejected all of Islam, and he sees you sitting there eating a doner kebab or something like that, and he knows that's all halal, and he says, why are you eating this? This is food sacrificed to Allah, and it's no good. You know, why you eat? Paul said, if I knew that would offend my brother, I would never eat any of that. I would never eat any of that ever again. Somebody that is weak in not in works, but in faith. But then he tells us, we know food sacrifice to God, that there is no gods. There's only one God. He's the creator of everything. And so I think Jesus even, how would I find this? When he sent out the 70, let's see here. Yeah. He said, go your ways. Behold, I send you forth as lambs among wolves. Carry neither purse nor scrip nor shoes, and salute no man by the way. And into whatsoever house ye enter, first say, peace be unto this house. And if the Son of Peace be there, your peace shall rest upon it. If not, it shall turn to you again. And in the same house remain, eating and drinking such things as they give. That's what Jesus said. So if I knew that in eating something that was marked halal might make some new Christian be offended or question the faith, I wouldn't do it. But the fact is, I know that all creatures that God gave us to be food, whether it's beef, pork, chicken, rats, yeah, people eat rats, and locusts, whatever, and grub, worms, okay, that's your diet, that's fine. I know that whatever God gave us to eat is beneficial to our bodies, giving us protein, giving us minerals, giving us the things that our body needs to sustain itself. And the body doesn't care who blessed it. So I would fall back on grace on this one. There's a chain of restaurants, I think they've pretty much gone out of business, but when I first went to Kenya, I was looking on Google Earth before I left, and I found this restaurant in Nairobi called Kinchik Inn. Get it? Kinchik Inn. And it's actually a poultry producer in Kenya. Kinchik is the name of the company, Kinchik. And their logo is, we go cuckoo over chicken. Well, cuckoo is the Swahili word for chicken. Makes sense. But they have these amazing restaurants. And I saw pictures of it, and I'm going, if I go to Kenya, I want to go there. And I told Michael about it, and he said, oh, yeah. So we go there, and it was as good as I thought it was. It's rotisserie chicken, and when you order it, they take the chicken off the rotisserie. They cut off what you ordered, like a half or a quarter of whatever. And then they drop it in a hot fat fryer, grease fryer, for about 3 or 4 minutes. And get the outside all crispy and oily and everything like that. And then they pull it out, put it on newspaper. And they put some seasoning on it, some salt. Give you these great big old chips. They call them fries, you know, big potato pieces that are about this big, and they serve it to you on that newspaper. And buddy, I'm telling you, that is good chicken. But they all went out of business. But all of those Kinchik Inns were certified halal. They had to be, because there's a lot of Muslims in Nairobi. Did eating that I'm still here. I'm still saved. I'm still preaching the gospel. It didn't hurt me. So now, again, if it's going to cause your brother to offend, I would stay away from it. But folks, remember that we still live under grace. And this subject, whether it's eating a certain kind of food or not eating a certain kind of food, you want to choose a diet for you and your family, you go for it. We've had all kinds of families visit our church. Some will, you know, we usually invite them to stay and eat dinner with us Sunday, and, you know, they eat whatever we fix. Some of them, they have special diets for them and their families, and that's fine. I respect that. I think it's good that you can do it. I can't do it. But don't make the mistake of believing that your dietary choices make you a better Christian than somebody else. Do not, and I know people that do, and you can apply that to anything. The clothes you wear, the way you cut or comb your hair, or whatever it is. People love to take things that they say, God told me to dress this way. God told me to be this way. And if God told me to be this way, then it must be right. And you're not that way, so you must be in sin. And that's how they see people. That's how they treat people. We're not saved by that. We are saved by grace through faith and not of ourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works. Because why? What do we do when we do works, people? We boast every single time. Well, God bless you. I love you. If there's one thing you get out of today, there's liberty. There's liberty in Jesus Christ. And all things can be proven or disproven simply by the Word of God. I hope you stick with that. I hope you believe that. Because that's what I believe. Pray for what I ask you to pray about. Who I ask you to pray for. Okay? Pray for me. Pray for our work in Kenya. Pray for our church. We'll pray for you. God bless you. Homecoming's coming up August 5th, 6th, and 7th. Film crew from Germany will be there on August 6th. I'm excited about that. So why don't you come and be part of that? They're gonna put you on TV, man. You gotta be there for that. Because I'll be honest with you, you make me look good.